Welcome to our second session on Gitpod and the technology behind it. And today we're going to talk about rootless workspaces, or how we gave our users root in their containers. My name is Christian Weichel. I'm the chief architect at Gitpod, and I'll guide you through this session today. So let's get started. Brief intro, what is Gitpod? Gitpod is a service, a project that gives instant, almost instant dev environments in the cloud, built for the cloud. And what that means is that you can start a dev environment from pretty much any GitHub repository instantaneously. You'll get an IDE, you'll get a Linux shell, you'll get all the tools that you know and want to use. And we do this by starting pods in a Kubernetes cluster. So when you start a workspace from a Gitpod, GitHub repository, for example, then we'll start a pod in a Kubernetes cluster. And we want that pod to be your home. We want it to feel like it's your local machine, except you get a new, fresh laptop for every task that you need to do. Ready, set up, ready to go. And we want it to feel like your laptop. But until recently, there were a few things that you just couldn't do. So for example, you could not run apt-get install and install something simply because you didn't have sudo, you weren't root. You couldn't run Docker either. So Docker builds, Docker compose, all of that didn't work. And what we set out with rootless workspaces was to enable exactly that. We wanted to make sure that the things you can do on your local machine, you can do in your workspace too. And so these are things you can do now. You can run apt-get install, you can run Docker containers, you can run Docker build, you can run Docker compose. And how do we make that happen? Well, one of the naive approaches would be, we just give you root inside your container, make your UID 0, give you all the privileges that you need to access and write on the root file system, give you all the privileges you would need and capabilities to run a Docker daemon inside your workspace. But clearly, this isn't a particularly good idea, because it would mean that we'd be giving every one of the users root privileges on a VM that is shared with many other users. It would also mean we'd be giving root privileges to a machine that might contain secrets of others, might contain secrets of the service. So clearly, this is not something that we would actually want to do. Don't do this in production, maybe at home. And this is where user namespaces come to the rescue. What user namespaces do is they map one user from inside that namespace to a different one outside of it, which means that inside this user namespace, you can be UID 0, aka root. And outside of that namespace, you would be, for example, UID 1000. So what that means is if you have a file, for example, that from within the user namespace looks like it is it belongs to 33333, for example. This happens to be the Gitpod user UID that we established at some point. Then outside of it, you would be a completely different UID. You can do the same thing for processes. So say you run something as root within your user namespace, then outside you'd be a different UID, even though to you it looks like your UID 0. So how do you create a user namespace? And it's actually quite simple. You need the unshare syscall. There are other syscalls that can do the same thing. They create a user namespace. And then you need to establish the mapping between the UID and GID from within that namespace to outside of that namespace. And we do that by writing to /proc PID of the namespace process, and then UID map and GID map. And lastly, there's an execve syscall so that you get all the capabilities within this namespace, like capsysadmin, capnetraw, etc. You can actually play with this yourself by calling unshare on a Linux machine. The -u starts a new user namespace. The -r maps your current user to the root user within that namespace. And the strace in front of this here shows all the syscalls that happen when this namespace gets created. There's a problem though. Writing to /proc UID map requires capsysadmin in the outer namespace, in our case, on the node. And this is exactly what we don't want to give workspaces. We don't want to give this amount of privilege and capability to workspaces. So we need to find a way around that. And so within a Gitpod workspace, the way this actually works is the init process that we start, sort of the root process of your workspace container, is what we call supervisor. And we start supervisor ring 0, who then executes itself in a username space as ring 1. And then ring 1 makes a gRPC call to a service that runs on the same node that we call workspace daemon. And workspace daemon will write that mapping for us. So we basically maintain or work around that lack of privileges in the workspace container by exporting or outsourcing this privileged operation to a different service. And note how we're passing the PID of the of ring 1 along here, along for the ride. And what workspace daemon then has to do is it has to translate that PID as seen from the workspace container to the PID namespace that workspace daemon lives in. Let me explain a bit. Containers, as you all know, are basically a collection of namespaces and other isolation technologies. And one of those namespaces is a PID namespace. And this is the reason that within any container, the root process of that container has PID 1, and it's not something else you would expect, like, I don't know, system D or so. And so that means that the PID 2 in this example that we receive from supervisor ring 1 is something that we need to translate to the PID on the node that workspace daemon can understand. And this translation isn't exactly straightforward. There is no syscall to do it. There's a host of trickery to do it, like, for example, some Unix pipe messages where the kernel does PID translation across namespace boundaries. The way we chose is in the status file of a process in the proc file system on Linux, there's an entry called nspid, and that lists the PID of this process in all PID namespaces that the process is in. And because we know that the process we're looking for must be a child of the container, of the workspace container, we can look at all the children of the workspace container process, look at its status file, and if we find a matching NSPID entry, then we found our process. And this is how we can do the PID mapping. All right, so now we have PID mapping. We have established the UID mapping. Very nice. We have a working user namespace. Now, there is one ID that we haven't mapped, and that's UID 0, at least not to the node. Meaning, in this user namespace, in this mapping that we've just established, there is no user within the namespace that maps to ID 0 outside of that namespace. The root file system of our container, however, actually belongs to ID 0 on the node, because this is how it was initialized by the container runtime. Because this user is unmapped, we see it as some odd UID from within our namespace. Let me elaborate on that a bit. This is what we would like to see, right? In our user namespace, if we look at the root file system, we would like to see everything belonging to root, maybe some other folders belong to a different user. In this example here, we're assuming a mapping from ID 0 within the namespace to ID 10,000 outside and user 33333 inside the namespace to 43333 outside, so always plus 10,000. Now, if we wanted to see this picture on the left in our user namespace, what that means is that on the file system on the node, we would actually need this situation. Basically, we would need the UID shift that our user namespace establishes. We would need that on the file system level. we could create this situation by change owning all the files, but that doesn't integrate so well with snapshots, and it would require modification of the snapshotter that is used by containerd on the in the Kubernetes installation, something we would like to avoid. We could alternatively have some process that sort of does this dynamically, like some file system that we could mount on top that does this ID mapping. And there are a few to choose from at the moment. One of the most prominent examples is Fuse Overlay FS. You can use that from within a user namespace, so you don't need privileges outside of that namespace. It has very, very little upfront cost. It's basically just a mount. But the runtime cost is considerably high because it's a userland file system. All file operations have to pass through userland, and this is what makes it expensive. It's not very platform specific though, because Fuse has been in the kernel for quite some time now. Then there is OverlayFS MetaCopy. OverlayFS supports a mode where any change to a file's metadata will not have the whole file copied up, but just something like a placeholder and with the changed attributes. So what we could do is we could mount another OverlayFS with MetaCopy on top and then do a change own. And this explains the high upfront cost, because a change own over the complete root file system of a container, especially if it's a big one, is fairly expensive. With regards to runtime cost, it's a bit better than Fuse OverlayFS. Two OverlayFS mounted directly on top of each other have some cost, but it's not all that high really. In terms of platform specificity, OverlayFS in mounted from a user namespace only works in Ubuntu. In on other distributions, you need privileges outside of the user namespace to do that. Speaking of Ubuntu, there is a file system called ShiftFS, which requires a privileged operation to make work, the so-called mark mount. Has very little upfront cost though, because it's primarily a mount. Has very little runtime cost too, but is very platform specific. To my knowledge, it only is available on Ubuntu. Because we have control over the environment in which we deploy this solution, we can choose to use Ubuntu. And we really do care about the upfront cost, because this directly impacts the workspace startup time, something we care a lot about. And this is why we ended up going with ShiftFS. Now, how does this work? I just mentioned that we need a privileged operation to make this ShiftFS work. And we employ exactly the same trick we did before for writing the UID mapping. We basically outsource this privileged operation to Workspace Daemon, who then prepares the mark mount. And then using this mark mount, we can basically assemble a new root file system. So we first use this mark mount to mount the shifted root file system. Then we do a bunch of bind mounts to get something like /dev/sys, mount proc. And then we start inside another PID namespace, we start ring 2. And in there, we pivot root into this new root file system. The reason we start a new PID namespace here is because we want to hide all this mechanism from workspace, from workload that runs within this workspace. Specifically, we want to avoid that someone can use /proc to navigate outside of this new root file system. Now there's a problem. We cannot mount proc. And even though proc is mountable from within a user namespace, we cannot mount it because our proc is masked. What does that mean? So there's a few files and objects within /proc that exist only once within the kernel, that are singleton objects within the kernel. For example, /proc kcore or /proc sked debug. And sked debug in particular, for example, might leak information about other namespaces on the machine. So this is nothing we want to give anyone access to. And this is why Kubernetes and other container runtimes and orchestration systems too support masking those files. And the Linux kernel, for quite a while, prevents users from mounting proc if the proc that they are seeing has masks, right? This is what makes it work. If this provision weren't there, then users could simply circumvent their proc mask by mounting proc again. To work around that, we rely on this good old trick of having workspace daemon do the work. Here, this is somewhat tricky because we have to navigate the different namespaces that we've built up at this point. But eventually, workspace daemon basically does the proc mount, applies the same masks that run C would do or Kubernetes, and then moves this mount into position. And this is how we can mount proc. Awesome. At this point, we have a workspace that looks and feels almost like root, but Docker isn't working yet. So we need to do something about that. Now, rootless Docker, i.e. starting Docker that doesn't require actual root privileges, there's heaps of prior art. Akahiro Suda has done a lot of work on this and has given many talks about this, has been great inspiration. Also, our friends from Kinfolk have been an indispensable help. Without them, none of this would have been possible. And there's also rootless containers, which gives a really good overview of sort of the state of the art. Now, how do we do this? So at this point, we're sort of in supervisor ring two, so in all those namespaces that I just described. And now we need one more namespace, namely a network namespace, in which Docker has free rein, in which it can use IP tables, in which it can create network devices. And we use slurp for net and S to make that connection work. This is a method that was developed as part of rootless kit and rootless containers and works really well for us. More on where we're going with this towards the end of this talk. Now, Docker will have to mount proc too, right? Because Docker starts containers. Containers are, amongst other things, PID namespaces, and hence they need their own proc mount so that /proc1, for example, points to the correct process. And as we've already established, we cannot simply mount proc, neither can Docker, because all the proc that Docker will ever see is masked. So again, we use that same trick. We use that mount proc method in workspace daemon to do the proc mounts. Now, this isn't quite as straightforward as it may sound, because what happens is Docker produces an OCI spec, hands that over to run C, and in that OCI spec, it says, well, mount under /proc, mount a proc file system. What we do to interject here is we have something that we call the run C facade, which gets called by Docker, modifies the OCI spec to register OCI hooks, and these hooks then do the proc mount for us. All right, enough talk about how this is all built. Let's see it in action. So here I have a Gitpod workspace, and I've already gone ahead and started a few processes. And on the right, I have a running Docker daemon, so I can do things like that. Right, so I have an Alpine container now. I can also run Docker builds. So this is our build system that we use for building Gitpod. And so here you can see it doing the build, doing copy. And the thing that fails now is the push because I'm not logged in to the registry. Right, but the Docker build itself actually worked. Let's look around inside this rootless workspace a bit. So if we look at the root file system, at root basically, we see that a lot of files belong to actual root, or belong to our mapped root, I should say. Right, and this is basically the shifted root file system that we created with shiftfs. We also see that some directories are not shifted, like /dev, for example, or /proc, which was created through workspace daemon, or /sys. Basically all directories that we just bind mounted. They are not shifted. We can also have a look at the process structure. Let me put this to the side. There we are. And we see that PID 1 here is ring 2. And this is what I said earlier. Ring 2 starts the PID namespace that we now run in. Right. So behind that, in the actual container, in the actual Kubernetes container, is still ring 1 and ring 0. Also, we now can write to the root file system. This R limit is an issue in sudo that has already been fixed. It's just the packages in Ubuntu aren't updated yet. Sudo still works though. It's just a message, a warning message. So if we go to root, I can now write files here. And writing an X into root isn't all that interesting. More importantly, I can do things like this. Right, so I can install packages. And this is really handy. This is not something you could do before. Right, where are we going now? So at this point, we had to build around some limitations, and a lot of those things are becoming easier. So for example, there's work underway for ID map mounts, which means that we don't need to use shiftfs anymore, because the kernel can create bind mounts with the UID shift. There is seccomp notify, which is really exciting, where using a seccomp program, in essence, you can interject syscalls and then execute those syscalls on the behalf of the caller. And this way we could do the proc mounts, for example. So, and then you could just do mount slash proc minus t proc, and we would see this mount syscall and execute it for you with all the masks in place. And then we wouldn't need all this workaround to talk to Workspace Daemon directly. And then also in yesterday's talk on rootless containers, Akahiro mentioned that there's going to be faster networking coming using seccomp addfd, which is something that came in kernel 5.9, I believe. And this will also make the slurp for net and S abundant. All right, to sum up, Gitpod provides dev environments built for the cloud that also run in the cloud. With user namespaces, we can provide functionality in those workspaces that we've been wanting for a long time, specifically being able to install packages afterwards and root and Docker. And also, none of this work would have been possible if it hadn't been for the great people in this community, specifically Kinfolk, Akahiro, and all the work that's been done around rootless containers, rootless Docker. Thank you very much for that. So there are questions coming in. I haven't specifically mentioned a release date for this yet. It will come before the end of the year, that's for sure. And within Gitpod, we'll introduce something called feature preview, which you'll be able to enable in the settings. And once you enable that, then your workspaces will start with this mode on, and you'll have root and Docker and everything I just described. So this will be coming before the end of the year for sure. Okay. Another question, does Docker Compose work with this as well? From the tests that we've done, the sort of preliminary tests, yes, it does. So for example, something like MySQL and WordPress as a Docker Compose show no problem. Other things that work also is, for example, port exposure. So if you start a workspace that exposes a port, if you start a container that exposes a port. So for example, like that. Right, then we realize that something just started with this port and we'll make that available to you. All right, that's it for today then. Thank you guys so much. Thanks everyone for joining, and see you in the Slack channel or at our booth. Thank you.